So we're going to talk about overview of file storage. Oracle Cloud Infrastructure File Storage Service provides a durable, scalable, distributed, enterprise-grade network file system. You can connect to a file system from any bare metal virtual machine or container instance in your VCN. You can also access a file system from outside the VCN, like the Fast Connect, through your on-site data center through a VPN. So large compute clusters of thousands of instances can use file storage service for high-performance shared storage. The benefit of using file system is you don't have to do any upfront provisioning, and it manages by itself. So you can go from a single byte to exabyte without any upfront provisioning. So uses of the file storage system. So it can be used for a wide variety of applications. We can start with enterprise applications like EBS, Oracle E-Business Suite, and any other Oracle applications which require NFS version 3 protocol, which EBS does, and others. It also can be used for analytical platform and Hadoop environments where you're currently using a local NFS file system. And you can use for databases, scale out file workloads, high performing computing, for graphics, video data. So you can use it for general purposes also for storing structured and unstructured data. So there are a few concepts you need to know about file systems. We've talked about file systems in the training one. So this is getting a little more into the details of file system. If you guys remember, we did a mount target. We ran SCSI commands. So mount target, it's an NFS end mount point that lives in a subnet of your choice and is highly available. It provides the IP address or DNS name that is used in the mount command when connecting NFS client to the file storage service. And again, you can create two mount targets per account per availability domain. But this is a hard limit from Oracle. It's not the technological limit. It's just limited by Oracle. And that can be increased if your requirements need that. Export path. So a path that is specified when a file system is associated with a mount target, it uniquely identifies the file system within the mount target, letting you associate up to 100 file systems to a single mount target. It is appended to the mount target IP address and used to mount the file system. This path is unrelated to any path within the file system itself or the client mount point. So anything what you append as extra file system, it's got nothing to do with the mount point where you are adding the file system. Snapshots. Snapshots are similar to the ones we talked about in training one. So they actually are a point in time view of your data at that time. So those are what snapshots are. So you can do that with file systems. And the best part is if you take a snapshot for a couple days ago, the next snapshot will not store everything which was in the file system. It's going to store only what has changed to the file system from the last snapshot. So this way it reduces the storage and actually makes it more efficient if you had to restore. If you had to restore, you would use the first snapshot and then use the second snapshot with only the data which is changed. If you had copied all the data from the start, it would take a lot of CPU to filter out what is not needed and what's not changed. So this makes sense. And that's the future about all kinds of backups. Encryption. The file storage service uses AES 128 encryption to encrypt all the file system by default. Encryption happens at the file level. Data and metadata encrypted at rest rather than while in transit. And most important, there is no way you can turn off the encryption on file systems. Data transfers, we talked about that last chapter, I believe, and also in the first training program, where we talk about Fast Connect. So Fast Connect offers the ability to accelerate data transfers. You can leverage the integration between a Fast Connect and the file storage service to perform initial data migration. Workflow data transfers for large files and disaster recovery scenarios between two regions. So what are the security requirements? So there are three layers for security, and we've again talked about this. The first layer is the Unix authentication layer. Unix authentication layer controls what users can do on the instance, such as installing application, creating directory, mounting an external file system which was created through Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. So that's where Unix authentication layer comes in. IP networking layer, which we've worked a few times, where we allow or disallow certain IP addresses to connect to your resources. And that's done by the security list. So that's another way of securing your file system. And finally, it's the Oracle Cloud Infrastructure OCI policy layer. This gives you an extra security of having certain users who can create the file systems and generate those SCSI commands. Not everyone can. So you can add this layer also to that. And finally, you have to keep in mind, the users in Unix aren't the same as in OCI. In Unix, you could have different users which can manipulate data on the Unix server itself, but they have no privileges on the Oracle Cloud Infrastructure. And it goes the other way also. So a Oracle Cloud Infrastructure user has no permission on the Unix server or the file system. These are two completely different areas. So you have to keep that in mind. Those are two different users. That's why they are put into different layers. So we're going to go into a lab workshop after this.